Hallelujah. Can everybody, can you hear me very well?
Yes, Father, we can hear you.
Okay. It's a beautiful reading we have taken today, and full of a lot of instructions for us. From that John chapter 6, the first thing we will notice, as we read from verse 2, and a large crowd was following him because they saw the signs that he was doing for the sick. So it is imagined that the multitude of the people that were there, they were looking for Jesus for healing. They were looking for a touch for Jesus to heal them. They could not, just like at the wedding at Canaan, they could not just imagine that Jesus would be concerned about bread. My dearly beloved in the Lord, the first thing that the Lord is saying that struck me here is that the initiative to feed the people was from the Lord Jesus Christ himself. Where are we to buy bread so that these people may eat? It was a divine initiative. They were looking for healing, and they would have been satisfied with their healing. But let me tell you something. God's plan for your well-being is totality. Let nobody think that God is interested in your suffering in terms of your hunger and wretchedness. God wants it well to be with you so that you can fulfill his assignment for your life. God wants us to serve him. He wants us to become a blessing. And the last thing that will become a problem to our life is our daily needs. Because as we go on in this passage, you will understand the way God thinks and the mentality of God. But the first thing we saw in the Lord Jesus Christ is that he looked at the multitude and he said, and he knew that they should also be hungry. Now, if you are hungry, God knows that you are hungry and he wants to feed you. Now, when God created man, for example, he planted a garden in Eden. In Eden, there was a garden. In that garden, everything that man would eat was created before man was born. Before human being was created, the food that man will eat was created. That is why it is outright wickedness for a nation, for a government, to make people to lack daily food. You know, let me just divert, but it's not a diversion, it's an explanation. It is only in this country. Sometimes when I go outside the country and it's Christmas, it's festive period, you will see that food becomes cheaper. Everything becomes cheaper. They want people to eat. During festive period here in Nigeria, everything will become expensive. But I can tell you that food, as mean, as little as it may be, it is part of the plan of God for all his creatures. And Jesus is very, very concerned about your well-being, about your feeding. In fact, if this is all we are going to say, or somebody is going to take home today, God is concerned that you are well, that you eat. And God never wants anybody to go hungry. A nation that cannot feed its people is already a failed nation. Now imagine in Luke chapter 8, verse 55, when Jesus killed Jairus' daughter, what did he say? He said, give her something to eat. And from that, we see the mercy, the compassion, and the understanding of our need. God understands your need. Jesus knows when you are hungry. He knows when you are in need. They did not ask him. He initiated that move. You know, just serving. The Bible said he went up a high mountain and they climbed the mountain with him. You know, Exodus 23, 25 says, and you shall serve the Lord your God, and he will bless your bread and your water. You see, what God is looking for from you, from me, is that serve him. If you serve him with your heart, the Lord is able to meet all your needs according to his riches in glory. Even the things that you will think that, how can God be interested in this? What God is just looking for is your service. Now, they were not in the plane while he was climbing the mountain. They followed him to the mountain. You can imagine the process of climbing. That is the process of growth. If you keep walking, you keep serving, you keep following the Lord, he will never, there will be plenty of things you will never ask for, and God is going to do for you. And Jesus said, give them something to eat. And that is the second point I'm going to tonight, my dearly beloved in the Lord. You know, when Jesus said, give them something to eat, please, I want to create an understanding. He said, give them something to eat. But listen, he knew that they cannot feed them. My dearly beloved in the Lord, number two, we must develop the wisdom to interact with divinity. Many people lack the wisdom to develop with, to interact with divinity. You know, in these days, you see a lot of people, they receive a word, they say God has spoken a word. They do not know how to exchange interaction with God. Now, let me give a funny example. Imagine that when the angel came to our blessed mother Mary, and the angel said to Mary, he said, you are going to have a child. Mary understood what the angel was saying. The angel was saying, in 9 months' time. If the angel just said, you will have a child one day, Mary said, amen, I will have a child after marriage. The angel was saying to Mary, in 9 months' time, you will be carrying the Savior of the world. Now, Mary did not say, did not go out and say, Joseph, oh, I saw a vision, clear vision, that I will have a child. This is July. Our wedding is September. But the angel has spoken. So as I've received prophecy, let's have a child. I know what I saw. No. Mary said to the angel, excuse me, sir. My wedding is December. I am still a virgin. How will this come about? And the angel said, yes, you got it right. We must learn how to interact with God. We must develop the wisdom to interact with divinity. How you respond to God's word, whether it is a rebuke, whatever it is, can change your story. People must talk with God. When you receive a word, when anything comes to you, know how to speak properly, not even just with God, with human beings. The way you discuss in your office with your boss, how you interact with your superior, can change a lot of things for you. How much more God? Let me give you two examples again on this, because this is very important. I have seen people, they don't know how to discuss with God. God told Eli through Samuel in 1 Samuel chapter 3, verse 18. He said, I'm going to take the kingdom from you. I'm going to break everything down. Do you know what Eli said in 1 Samuel 3:18? He said, it's God, let him do whatever he wants to do. He thinks he's pious. He's thinking that, hey, is God anything like I surrender? No! God told David in 2 Samuel chapter 2, verse 13, that you will die. David prayed and said, don't let me die. I'm a stupid boy, but don't let me die. And instantly in that verse, God said, you will not die again. You must learn how to interact with divinity. Now, don't be too positive not to be able to tell God, Baba, this thing is difficult for me. I don't know how to come about. Open up to God. Learn how to open up to God. Nobody goes to their doctor and says it is well when they are sick. You remember the Shunammite woman? When she met people on the road, she said it is well. But when she met Elisha, she said it is not well. You must know the difference between talking with God, the difference between talking with your priest or talking with ordinary people. Some people will be saying it is well, where they need to say it is not well. Some people will even see the camouflage in front of God. Imagine that Philip, Andrew, they say, he said, give us something to you. They say, yes, sir. Yes, sir. They begin to run a scatter. Now, what God, what Jesus was expecting for them, because he himself knew what he was going to do, was for them to say, Lord, how will this happen? Open up to God. Learn how to just tell God the truth. If you are having challenges, you are facing temptation, you are facing trials beyond your power, don't say, Lord, I know, as a man, you are nothing. Just lie down and say, Lord, this thing matter is still in my head. I am still hungry to fight. I know that I have beaten, I am still annoyed inside me. Just be free with God. Open up yourself with God. It is a very critical matter in our relationship with God. Now, you can act in front of human beings. There are people you can act because they can mock you. There are people you act as if you are capable in their presence. But there are some places that you don't need to act. Mary did not act. She just said, how will this happen? I am still a virgin. In 9 months' time, our wedding is December. In 4 months' time, should we move the wedding to tomorrow? And the angel said, yes. Good question. The Holy Spirit is going to be responsible for that conception. Talk to God from your heart. Don't hide anything from him. Just like your doctor, you have to tell your doctor exactly how you are feeling. When God speaks a word to you, even if the word is negative, know how to interact. Your ability to interact with God in situation can change the game plan. Ability to interact with God in every situation can change the game plan. And that is a ministry of wisdom. That is why the Bible said, if anybody lacks wisdom, let them pray. When God speaks, sometimes it is to test. But if, like Eli, you accept the verdict, he says, so be it. Sometimes when God speaks, even though his word is final, God still gives space for change if he finds people that know how to interact with him, that knows how to beg, that know how to explain, that know how to humble themselves, that know how to submit. Number three. Now, this is very important, my dearly beloved in the Lord. Philip answered him, 200 denarii worth of bread will not be enough for each of them to get a little. Don't let me go into that. Because if you see the oil that they use at the feet of Jesus, that's a message for another day, how much it is. Now, one of his disciples, Andrew, Simon Peter's brother, said to him, there is a boy with 5 barley loaves and 2 fish. Now, we are talking of multitude of 5,000 men. Maybe he also not counting women and children. Imagine a multitude of 10,000 people, even if it is 5,000 people. How did they locate that boy? That boy came out of the multitude with his bread. How? This is what God is looking for. Men that present themselves to him. Men that were not set out by other men. Men that brought themselves willingly at the service of the Almighty. And I think that God is creating a new generation of young people who understand how to touch the heart of God. Now, are we going to say it's only that boy that has bread in the multitude? In the multitude of the people, maybe there is somebody that have 20 loaves. A little boy. Now, I pray for every young person that God is going to build up in this generation. Now, when I'm talking of young, God started journey with Abraham at 75. You are still very young. God is going to recreate new people that know how to position themselves with God. I do not see how they located this boy in the multitude. The boy must have brought himself out. A little boy heard them that they were talking about bread. And the boy said, I have bread. So you can imagine how dramatic it was. When this boy met Andrew, he said, excuse me, sir. My mommy gave me 5 loaves yesterday when we were coming. I ate, he gave me 7. I ate 2, his remaining 5. All this small, small round bread. Small, small round bread. And 2 fish. Maybe 1 tail, 1 head. He said, this is what I have. I heard that they needed food. Andrew was laughing. He said, what is your name? I mean, let us just give the boy.
Michael.
He said, what is your name? Oh, no. Wait, your 5 loaves and 2 fish cannot feed people. When we are talking that we need food, it's not your type of food. Eh? God bless you, little boy. And then they were joking with it with Jesus, and they stood the matter. They said, we don't know where to get bread. Therefore, there was one small boy. The boy is very funny. He said, his name is Michael Domingo. He just came from somewhere, and he said he has 5 loaves and 2 fish. So we have sent him away. Jesus said, go and call that boy. You people don't know what I'm looking for. 2 generations. God is the one searching and begging, searching and begging, searching and begging people, serve me, dig me, build church for me, do this for me. I am looking for a place to dwell. He said, a boy came out himself with his bread. I know how stingy we were when we were small. I know when we were in body house, how will we open our biscuit at the back? When you look at it from the front, I say, I've not opened. But we have opened at the back. By the time people will come, say, when are you opening? The thing is finished. And this boy brought, Jesus said, call the boy for me. And when the boy came, Jesus said, what is your name? Everybody knows his name now. He said, my name is Michael Domingo. And then he said, what do you say? He said, I have 5 loaves. Why did you bring it? He said, I hear that there's no food. I said, maybe they will share. Jesus looked at the boy. He said, bring me that your bread. You can imagine how Jesus would lay hand on the boy. He said, don't worry, one day you'll be a priest. He laid hands on the boy, he blessed him. You don't know what that meant to Jesus. When Jesus was giving thanks to the bread, he needed to work a miracle. He needed somebody's platform. My dearly beloved in the Lord, everything God will accomplish on this earth. I watched the video of VGC last Saturday, and they said under 1 year they will build the church. It is not impossible to build that church under 1 year if God will find that boy who will bring his 5 loaves and 2 fish to the Lord and say, I give it to you. I give it to the multitude. There is something that God is looking for. Men and women will bring themselves out for him. Not people that you cajole. Not people that you whine and you talk for long. I can tell you, that boy came out. There is no way. He's too small to be found with bread. God needs your platform. God needs your life, your resources, your platform to work his miracle. And at the peak of men that delight the heart of God are the men who come out of their own. Men who will come in the midst of the multitude who are holding the blessing of God in their lives. There are so many people, what they do for God does not resemble the weight of what God has been doing for them. But I see today a pattern of what God is looking for in my life, a pattern of what God is looking for in the world today, a pattern of what God is looking for in his church today. A boy whose bread is not even enough to carry him until the next day, but he was willing to share it with Jesus for the multitude. Are you that person? Are you that person that look at what is in your hand? Let me share a story with you. Some years ago, this should be about 10 years ago, in my parish there, 10 years ago, because yes, when I celebrated my 10 years anniversary, I had a gardener in that parish. So I gave something to the wife, some clothes, and I gave some foodstuffs to my gardener's wife. So the husband came to see me to report the wife to me. And the husband told me that the 4 Congos or 5 Congos of rice I gave the wife, that is remaining only 1 Congo after 2 days, that it doesn't know what is wrong with the wife. So I called the wife. They have 2 children. I called the wife. So when I called the wife, I said, what happened? The wife was a cleaner in the church. The husband was gardener. If you combine the salary of 2 of them, after they received promotion, I promoted them. They were like the poorest of the poor. And do you know what the woman told me? The woman told me that I gave it to poor people in our neighborhood. And immediately she said that, I hear the voice of God clearly say to me, train those children for her. The diocese took one of the children on scholarship, and I paid for the other child. In fact, the firstborn finished secondary school as the senior prefect in a Catholic school, and they were trained with scholarship. God said to me, this wretched woman saw poor people around her. And that is how the children got scholarship. They were no longer paying bills. God is looking for people who will present themselves. Nobody will set you out. You will come out and say, I have 5 loaves and 2 fish. I am surrendering it for anything Jesus wants to accomplish. Now, the miracle we are talking about is a joint combination of the power of God and the sacrifice of a man. The power of Jesus to multiply, but it was not going to multiply nothing. There is nothing possible for God to do, but it is somebody that pays the price for Jesus. It is somebody's platform that Jesus will ride on. It is somebody's donkey that he has never ridden before that Jesus has to use for his triumphant journey before his death. God is looking for men who can make unbelievable sacrifices for him. You see that boy? That boy, he came out himself. I pray for somebody today that God will open your eyes to understand the immensity and the gravity of glory when a man presents himself for God. When a man gives to God what ordinarily other people will never do. No wonder God said to Abraham, because you have done this. You know, because you have done this means you have done it again, what you used to do. And because you have done this also means because you have done what others will never do. He said, blessing, I bless you. Multiplying, I multiply you. And the Bible said, the angel of the Lord appeared to Abraham a second time. He said, Abraham, Abraham, you do this thing that others will not do for me. Blessing, I will bless you. Multiplying, I will multiply you. Now, number 4. This is very important. Please listen to me before I allow people to answer questions, to ask some questions. Now, when Jesus had finished blessing, giving thanks, he said, God, I thank you. I came to this world to work miracle. Thank you for this boy that we named Michael Domingo, for giving us the platform, giving heaven the platform. Maybe some God is going to be thanking somebody and will be thanking God for helping us to finish the church in record time. Thank you for accomplishing this mission through this person. And as Jesus gave thanks, he asked them to give them the bread. Now listen to what he said. Jesus then took the loaves, and when he had given thanks, don't forget, he thanked God, not just for the loaves. He thanked God for the boy that gave him a platform to work his miracle. And I pray that the next miracle God is going to work in your church, in your parish, heaven, Jesus is going to be thanking God for your life. He's going to be thanking God for you. He's going to be happy that he has been able to do the impossible because of you. I pray that God, our Heavenly Father, will be delighted. His name will be glorified. He will be exalted because of you in the name of Jesus Christ. That is my own heart desire. I am looking for that day when I will reach heaven and Jesus will tell me, thank you, 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 my son. Thank, and he will give me hug. And people will be waiting. If they say, Jesus, they say, wait first. I pray that you will be the person that God, Jesus will be giving thanks that I thank you, my daughter. Thank you, my daughter. Because of you, everything is happening for me. My mission on earth is accomplished. What I want to do in my church is accomplished. What I want to do in the life of people is accomplished. You are the person Jesus will be giving thanks to heaven for in the name of Jesus Christ. Now, the Bible says, Jesus then took the loaves when he had given thanks. He distributed them to those who were seated. So also the fish as much as they wanted. As much as they wanted. But they were seated. Listen to me. There is something about being seated. And I think I understand this very well. Because I'm in secondary school. Sometimes when we want to share something for the children, you say, sit down. And then they refuse to sit down. You say, I am not going to give you if you don't sit down. There is something about being seated with God. See, let me tell you. The Bible said in Isaiah chapter 12, verse 3, it says, with joy, you will draw water from the well of salvation. If you don't sit, you are not fed. If you don't sit, you are not fed. If you don't sit, you are not fed. Many people are too anxious. Many people are too depressed. Many people are too agitated. But the pattern of divine help is you will first sit down. You will trust him. You will have faith in him. You will trust his love. You know, that's why people cannot offer their loaves, because they are anxious, they are afraid that if I do this, will God respond? The bread was given to those who are seated. It is a very clear instruction. And that is how God, look at our father Abraham. The Bible said Abraham believed and Sarah believed. Then they had their Isaac. For 25 years, God was teaching him how to be seated, how to trust him, how to calm down, how to trust his faithfulness, how to trust his love, how to trust his mercies. How to allow God to be God and you are man. See, you must calm down. Now, there is water in the well of salvation. Sorry, I just brought something as an example. Now, this is what they call a drawer. We use it here in the body house. You may not know this. Because water comes from... Sometimes we don't have water from the tap. We have a reservoir. The students will use this to fetch water. Now, the reservoir is full, but without this, you cannot draw water. Now, the Bible says, with joy, you will draw water from the wells of salvation. Everything you need, look, that bread is more than enough. You will have more than you can eat. Everybody ate as much. After they finished eating, there were extra baskets. Now, there is water inside the well, but without this drawer, you cannot draw. And the Bible says you will draw with joy. Joy is your drawer. And nobody can have joy if they are not rested. That is why when Jesus resurrected, the first thing he said is, peace be unto you. He said, if you enter any house, your first word must be peace. We must learn how to calm down. We must learn how to trust God. There are so many things God is going to do for you, but it will come when you calm down, when you trust him, when you build confidence. That is why the Bible says, building on your most holy faith. They call your faith your most holy faith. We must learn how to trust God. We must learn how to allow God to be God. Anxiety, depression, sadness and sorrow will hinder us from entering into the fullness of God. Unbelief did not allow them to enter into the promise. The promised land was ready. Everything was ready. God was going to break the wall of Jericho, but they needed to believe in him. Maybe there is somebody listening to this Bible study today. The only thing between you and your inheritance is your trust in God. It's your faith in God. You need to learn how to sit down. Now, bread is available with fish. You cannot even finish what God has for you. But it's not going to be given to you until you sit down. Until you rest in him. Until you trust him. Until you build confidence in him. Until you are joyful. And your joy is the evidence of your rest. And when you are joyful, then you have a draw. You already have a draw. With your joy, you begin to draw from the wells of salvation. Unfortunately, it is not the way it works in on earth that it works in heaven. In the patterns of heaven, it gives to those who are rested. It gives to those who sit down. Which is easier? To climb on a tree, to stand up and be shouting, or to sit down and be relaxed? It appears that we all know that it is easier to sit, but the journey to learn to trust God is a hard journey. Many people, what is standing between them and what God wants to do for them is the ability to sit, the ability to trust, the ability to rest. Just sit on the green grass. It makes me lie down in green pastures. It makes me wanting for nothing. It filled my hunger with honey from your sweet, sweet rock. Learn how to sit. Depression, sorrow, sadness, I have discovered, is a hindrance to a man receiving from God. And you know the problem with sorrow and depression? The problem with sorrow and depression is that it likes to sympathize. I don't know whether it has happened to you before. It has happened to me until God began to teach me. You know, sometimes you are sad. If anybody tells you not to be sad, you'll be annoyed with the person. You know, that sorrow used to like sympathy. It wants to tell you that that is you. You need a season of, you feel that is a way to compensate yourself by being sad. But that sadness is a yoke that will hinder you from receiving. Food is ready. Everything is ready. He says, sit down. Some people stood up. He says, give only those who are seated. My dearly beloved in the Lord, you need to learn how to calm down. You need to know how to be seated. You need to know how to trust God, no matter the circumstances. And do you know what? When you begin to learn how to trust God, like our father Abraham, what did he say to Abraham? It is not a division. It is not an addition. 1 + 1 = 2. But what happened to those loaves was multiplication. When you grow in faith and you begin to trust God, you are not just going to see double. You are going to see a multiplication. You know, it is, okay, there is water in the well of salvation. All that is required is joy. And you are sad. And what you are looking for responds only to joy. It doesn't respond to sadness. But sadness is saying, sympathize with me. You need to be sad. How can your husband be talking like that to your wife? Be sad. And do you know what that sadness is doing? It's taking away from you what you will use to draw the solution to your problem. I heard somebody was sharing a story of how people were healed of cancer. They were taking them to laughter therapy. Even if the laughter is not entering your heart, laugh until it becomes the real you. Laughter therapy. People came out. They are using it in the U.S. now in some places. In fact, the Bible said, a merry heart will do it good as medicine. But a broken spirit will destroy the remaining thing in your life. It was a clear instruction. and the breath to those who are seated, all those who have calmed down, all those who can smile, all those who can worship, all those who can be joyful. The Bible said, be anxious for nothing. Clear instruction. A lot of us are too depressed. You see, that depression is a satanic stronghold that is looking for your sympathy. You know, especially women, sometimes when they are sad, they are very happy with their sadness. Oh, because you know, sadness has a way of making you to be sadly happy, happy with the sadness. You will be feeling that, yes, you are showing, you are compensating yourself with sadness. Now, physically, a lot of sickness has been attached to sadness and depression. Once somebody's blood pressure is high, the first thing they ask you, is it in your family? The second question is, what are you thinking? What is making you sad? But whereas your joy, which is an evidence of your rest and your faith, is what gives you access to the solution. So why don't you choose joy? The same effort you will use to be sad is the same effort you will use to be joyful. And whenever God touches your resources, touches your life, when your 5 loaves and 2 fish enter the hand of God, it will end up in multiplication. Many people are hoarding themselves. They are hoarding the fullness of themselves for God. Like that boy, he came out of himself. If you can bring yourself out, you know, I was telling my student the other day, if your parents send you to go and buy something, and you say, I will not go, and they beat you to go, when you buy it, they will eat it, they will not give you. But if mommy says, go and buy me something, and you say, yes, mommy, I will go, and you run and bring it, she may likely give you something there. For people who bring themselves out, God will not only give them a double, he will give them multiplication. How can your bread and your fish hold this boy? Or whoever that person is representing, see what God has done with your little resources. See what God has done with your love. It has become a multiplication for the multitude of the people. Maybe that was not the only boy that had bread, but that was the only boy that brought himself out. Do you know the shame when Jesus multiplied that 5 loaves? Even those who ordered their bread was useless to them. Because when Jesus blessed when Jesus did the miracle at wedding at Cana, the wine was better. So I believe that when Jesus multiplied that bread and fish, the fish was better. Heavenly fried. The bread was softer. The bread the boy brought was cold, though. But by the time Jesus multiplied, it was soft. It was hot. Those who are holding their bread, shame unto them. Even their bread became useless in their hand. Because the soft bread that Jesus multiplied and the fried fish, there was still extra. Do you know what they did with their bread? They threw it away. They started joining us to pack. My dearly beloved in the Lord, I pray for you that God will find his rest in you. God is looking for somebody. I say, if I have only this, my daughter, this, my son, I am okay. Now you are that person. You are that person. You are that person.